Welcome to this afternoon's session. I'm Dave O'Connor from the Philosophy Department here at Notre Dame. And it's a real pleasure for me to introduce two guys with intimate Notre Dame connections of their own. Our second speaker will be Professor Tom Hibbs, now at Baylor. And Tom was still a graduate student when I started here in 85, just completing his dissertation. It was the first dissertation I read as a faculty member, and it's perfectly fine. So.
I was waiting to hear this.
That's it. It's at long last. He's and another signal event of my first year was when I gave a colloquium paper here, and Jorge Garcia was then on the faculty in the philosophy department, and he was the commentator. And I believe as we were in his office discussing the paper, I looked out his west-facing window and saw a tornado going past the Golden Dome up in the sky. So I don't know if either Tom's thesis or Jorge's tornado were beautiful experiences, but they were certainly sublime. So I'm glad to welcome them back here. Jorge Garcia, besides teaching at Notre Dame, he's also been on the faculty at Georgetown and at Rutgers before going to his present position at Boston College, where he's a professor in the philosophy department. He's written on a whole big list of stuff here, but today I'll just let you listen to him as a film guru. So we're looking forward to that, and very much welcome him back to Notre Dame. It's great to have you back, Jorge. And we'll look forward to your talk. And I don't have the official title here. Let me see. The Passion and the Reaction. And I welcome Jorge Garcia.
Thank you very much. I want to thank the center for the invitation and Notre Dame for sponsoring these conferences, and have several of them now, and they're, as you know, at least as well as I, they're extraordinary events which have a real sense of excitement and mission, very much revitalized by the presence of the many undergraduates here from different places. What I'm going to be doing today, and just rather briefly, is taking you through some of the issues that swirled around the film The Passion of the Christ. I want to begin with this quotation from Bernard Shaw. This is from Shaw's preface to his play Androcles and the Lion. Says the New Testament tells two stories for two different sorts of readers. One is the old story of the achievement of our salvation by the sacrifice and atonement of a divine personage who was barbarously slain and rose again on the third day, the story as it was accepted by the apostles. And in this story, the political, economic, and moral views of the Christ have no importance. The atonement is everything, and we are saved by our faith in it, and not by works or opinions, other than that particular opinion, bearing on practical affairs. The other is the story of a prophet who, after expressing several very interesting opinions, from Shaw, that's a compliment to Jesus, after expressing very interesting opinions as to practical conduct, both personal and political, which are now of pressing importance, and instructing his disciples to carry them out in their daily life, then lost his head, believed himself to be a crude, legendary form of God, and, under that delusion, courted and suffered a cruel execution in the belief that he would rise from the dead and come in glory to reign over a regenerated world. In this form, the political, economic, and moral opinions of Jesus as guides to conduct are interesting and important, whereas the resurrection and so on are not taken as particularly important. Now, in case there were any doubts, Shaw makes it pretty clear that he is not a reader of the first sort. Indeed, he thinks that the entire story of the atonement is absurd and relies on a moral view, vicarious punishment, which he thinks is barbarous and certainly pre-modern. Indeed, in his view, punishment in general is barbarous and pre-modern. So this particular sort of vicarious punishment is all the worse. So while he does a good deal in this preface to express admiration for Jesus, that is, for the teachings of Jesus, while also giving his own psychological interpretation of what he sees as Jesus' psychopathology, he makes it fully clear where he stands. So he says, "I am no more a Christian than Pilate was, or you, gentle reader. And yet, like Pilate, I greatly prefer Jesus to Annas and Caiaphas." Now, I think that this distinction between two sorts of readers of the New Testament, and especially two sorts of readers of the ends of the last chapters of the four Gospels, is illuminating in looking at the recent discussion of the Passion of the Christ, because it becomes quite clear early on that those who are looking, that many of the critics of the Passion, of Mel Gibson's film, see it as flawed primarily, at least with respect to its Christian vision, because of the way in which it slights Christ's teachings in favor of Christ's life, and especially Christ's death. Stanley Kaufman, by the way, cites this passage from Shorshaw. I'd made somewhat similar remarks a few years earlier in the preface to Major Barbara, as well, making a distinction between the two sorts of approaches or understandings of the life of Christ and therefore understandings of Christianity. Kaufman simply cites this at the end of his review and then goes on to say, so for the other kind of reader, other than the sort who concentrates on the atonement, Gibson's film offers nothing but suffering and extended really sort of wallow in degradation. Gary Wills, writing the New York Review of Books, complains that many of the movie's defenders seem more concerned to criticize its critics than to articulate the film's merits. And if you look at the controversy at the time, he has a point. For some of us, in the context of its February theatrical release, Gibson's movie is somewhat like the black painting at the center of the play Art. That is, it's especially important for the psychological responses that it evokes and for what they reveal about the character and perhaps flaws of the people who have them. Several of the comments of the film, especially negative ones, have been hyperbolic, insensitive, sometimes misinformed, and arrogant. Some have gestured towards disciplines and fields of research in which little knowledge is not only a dangerous but sometimes a ludicrous thing. So we get film critics lecturing us on more recent styles of the visual arts, on recent Vatican documents on how the Passion ought to be portrayed, different interpretations of Christ's redemptive mission, and so on. And these are not always uplifting, reading through these speculations. Some of them show narrow obsessions and launch lunatic criticisms. Consider Leon Wieseltier's complaint in The New Republic that he found the actor's pronunciation of Aramaic to be risible. As I recall, it drew no laughs in the multiplex where I saw the film. And some of them have combined erudition with a startling lack of charity or failure to follow a line of discussion to its sensible conclusion. So I want to do here, somewhat briefly, is just to look at a couple of the more serious kinds of charges. And this is by way of articulating a kind of response, what I hope to be a more measured and thoughtful response, really set the stage for that. I'm not really going to go much into that here now, half a year later. So what I'm going to be talking about then are chiefly some criticisms from the beginning of the year, from the time of the film's release. However, I should put this in context by saying that the point of this is to help us get beyond those early and initial responses.
Just yeah.
do than I realized. Could you just pull it back, maybe something towards you?
There's just a bunch of people I can't see.
Might be able to get up here.
So. Yeah, that's fine. That's good. Thanks.
Will that work?
Yeah. Thanks so much. Recently, there have been several books published on the film, so I'll draw your attention to those. Released by Miramax Books. If you're like me, you probably didn't know that there was such a thing as Miramax Books. And contains essays by Philip Cunningham and a number of others. Philip Cunningham is a theologian, my colleague at Boston College, and he has also edited a new collection, which isn't yet available, but is already in press. That one's called Pondering the Passion. Both Cunningham's book and this one just doesn't have a an editor, but it may be sometimes found it under Boyes, B-O-Y-S. Mary Boyes is the first of the contributors in it. These contain several of the more severe criticisms, including Leon Wieseltier's, a revised version of Leon Wieseltier's February essay on the book. And they're chiefly by biblical scholars and some theologians, also by people who work in Christian-Jewish relations, dealing with the book largely, not exclusively, but for the most part and predominantly from a fairly negative perspective. Another book is by my near namesake, Jorge Gracia, Jorge J.E. Gracia, at State University of New York at Buffalo. His book is titled, his edited collection is Mel Gibson's Passion and Philosophy. This is in that Popular Culture and Philosophy series. And in this, we got some a number of more measured responses by philosophers considering the nature of atonement, ethical issues about of the sort that Wieseltier and some of the others have raised about the morality and the philosophy of moral responsibility in the context of vicarious punishment, issues about how to understand scriptures and several others. So what I'll be doing here then is, in a way, sort of a contribution, I hope, to a transitional phase, looking back retrospectively on the initial controversy from the spring in order to help shift the new discussion towards the end of the year books, some of which, as I said, rehash in slightly revised form some of those criticisms from the beginning of the year, some of them going at things rather rather differently. Of course, the most volatile of the charges that was raised against the book is that of anti-Semitism, excuse me, against Gibson's film, was that of anti-Semitism. In fact, virtually no one really charged that Gibson meant the book to incite violence or against Jews, nor to express hatred of Jews. But even if the book, even if the work rather was not done from bad intentions, right, as those you know, the doctrine of double effect would see, that doesn't serve to exonerate it, right? We then have to see whether or not there's proportional reason for such risks or dangers as were involved in the presentation of the film or that's being made public. Of course, that requires two parts, right? First, you have to have some calculation of the harm that is envisioned and its nature, its magnitude, and also its probability on the one hand, and then also look to what good is to be done. In fact, although many people have charged anti-Semitism against the film, few have undertaken to give a reasoned response to the first part of that, right? So if they see the book as being anti-Semitic, not in the sense of being a product of hatred or of an effort to harm Jews, but rather reflecting an insufficient devotion to respecting Jews, that is, taking an action that could bring harm to Jews without adequate responses, then they need to say more, I've suggested, about what the nature of the harm is that's envisioned and its probability. And, of course, some of the defenders of the film have been quick to point out that, so far as can be seen, little or no physical harm has been directed against Jews because of the film's release, nor was this particularly likely. It wasn't simply that Gibson got away with it. You know, he did this really risky thing, but so far there haven't been pogroms inside it, but rather the suggestion was unreasoned, that it lacked real justification in the first place. And so there have been discussions of the changing nature of anti-Semitism, which has, to a large extent, it's been suggested, migrated from Christians, and more generally from the right, to secular and oftentimes anti-religious movements on the left. Or when there is a religious element, it tends to be within anti-Semitism. Of course, it's chiefly found these days more in Islam than in at least mainstream Christianity. So the likely harmful effects, I think, are still indeterminate. On the other hand, we can see that various forms of good seem to have emerged. One of the most striking early responses to the release of the film was the special issue, the March issue of Christianity Today, which contained four or five essays on the film. And I think that these individually and collectively indicate the building of important bridges and a real possibility for ecumenical, an opportunity for a new and revivified and deepened ecumenism. So, for example, it was in these essays, and really in a few other places, at least that I saw, and I went through a good deal of this literature, that one found the film tied to the not only to the tradition of the Stations of the Cross, but more explicitly to the Sorrowful Mysteries. It was in these pages that we found sometimes evangelical Christians reminding one another that the Reformation, that the founders of the Reformation did not have a view of Christ that was simply a cheerful one. Even if the crucified Christ has been removed from the cross in most of the familiar iconography, they reminded us that both Luther and Calvin enjoined their followers seriously to reflect on Christ's suffering as a fundamental way of entering into the Christian life. Similarly, a second advantage, I think, is that it's caused a certain revisiting of the writings of some of the mystics, as well as reflections and a renewed interest in other spiritual writings. So this has become this is a book that wasn't often seen around last year, but now reissued and popping up at least in many of the bookstores around Cambridge, where I tend to frequent, The Dolorous Passion of Our Lord Jesus Christ, by Anne Catherine Emmerich. People who have read about it know that to say it's by Anne Catherine Emmerich is a bit of an overstatement, right? What we have are Clemens Brentano's version or product from his conversations and sessions of listening to the mystic nun. And there's a good deal of dispute about just how much of what he published, in fact, he got from her. And my understanding is that as the case for Emmerich's canonization moves slowly through the Vatican, that the book itself has been removed from consideration, right? So it's not really clear to what extent it reflects her own views. Nevertheless, Gibson is quite explicit in saying that this is one of the works that he looked to for inspiration in trying to figure out how to visualize the story of the Passion. In addition to that, it counters a third advantage, or a good that the film seems to me to have at least begun to achieve, is to serve as an important, at least pop culture counterweight to to the kind of feel-good Christianity epitomized in many works, but the 60s theatrical works and later film versions of Godspell and Jesus Christ Superstar especially come to mind. Right? So the film and the furor over it serve to remind us quite mortally that Christ came to divide. And this it serves as an important cultural element in, within a Christianity that has far too often lately been distorted towards the cheerful banner of the good news without sufficient reflection on the very sad and disturbing and indeed tragic elements within the good news. My fellow panelist here, Tom Hibbs, in his couple of essays that he wrote around the time of the film's release, I think insightfully compared Gibson's Jesus with the memorable Buddy Christ image from Kevin Smith's film Dogma. It's a controversial film. There's a lot to criticize and simply to dismiss in the film, but probably the best thing about the movie Dogma was the grinning, cheerful Jesus who, smiling, flashes all of us the thumbs up on the future. So I think it could be something of a counterweight to that. Unfortunately, although this was, I think, the best element in Smith's film, now he is quoted as himself saying that he, quote, prefers Buddy Christ to Bloody Christ, but then adds, hey, but that's just me. Well, let's hope that it's chiefly him, if not only him. One point that several of the critics made at the time, and oftentimes as a criticism of Gibson's film, but something I want to suggest is, in fact, one of its beneficial or advantageous features, is that it helps to revivify a graphic depiction of, a graphic tradition, rather, of depicting Christ and the Via Dolorosa. Indeed, that so actually two parts. First, that it helps to revivify this tradition, which has, as many of the critics at the time suggested, has fallen into desuetude since the Renaissance. Much has changed in the intervening five centuries, but that has it right that the emphasis on Christ's suffering, which was characteristic of much, not all, but important pieces, certainly within medieval Christian iconography, have largely vanished in favor of more Stoic. A vision of Christ as relatively unmoved, dispassionate, perhaps triumphant, but not in the midst of sorrows. One, not the only one, but one important exception to that, one that, if I recall, David Denby cites rather dismissively to this newer tendency to depict the Passion, is in the tradition, especially Southern Italy, but perhaps most especially Hispanic traditions. Right. So one or two of the critics commented rather demeaning, rather snidely, superciliously, that the visuals that you get in this film are like the ones you might see along the roadside in traveling through Mexico, garish, bloody Christs being crucified, in contrast with the tradition of the High Renaissance. It was certainly striking to me that this is the sort of claim that I would think in most contexts would be taken in just the opposite way. That is to say that here somebody has helped to revivify what was a long and distinguished visual tradition, to renew it, to reconfigure it, and indeed, of course, to put it into an entirely new medium, right? Shifting from painting to and sculpture to cinema, but in here, but instead in the controversial in the context of the controversies of the film, it was simply taken as a negative. It's just the fact that this was post-Renaissance iconography was sufficient reason to condemn it. But this showed just how bad it was. And in fact, of course, it might help us to get away from the kind of, to overcome, to move beyond the kind of Renaissance iconography that starts out as humanistic, but can easily slide into the irreligious. That is an emphasis not simply on human dignity, but on the dignity of humanity divorced from any spiritual dimension. A different way of thinking about the charge. So the first way of interpreting the charge of anti-Semitism, then, just sort of passed over quickly, was that it was somehow an act of hatred or meant to instill or to incite violence against Jews. The second one, I think, was rather more serious, but I think that it wasn't seriously prosecuted. Right. The second charge was that there was a danger of violence to or increased hostility to Jews. But as I said, at least in the context of the principle of double effect, any such danger needs to be, could be in principle, counteracted by pointing to proportional reason. It itself needs to be identified both in its nature, in its magnitude, and in its probability, and then we have to see the countervailing advantages. I tried to point out the advantages and the silence of critics on in their responsibility to address the first matter, just what these dangers were and how likely they were. A third kind of charge, then, is that the Jewish characters are stereotyped. It seems to me, once one looks at the film, one sees that this is exaggerated. Some Jews certainly are shown as wicked, but as Father Newhouse and others have pointed out, it presumably is demanding too much to say that in order to avoid anti-Semitism, one has to exonerate Caiaphas and Herod. After all, some members of the Sanhedrin in the film are shown as protesting the trial's irregularities, even calling it a travesty in the subtitles. Simon of Cyrene helps Jesus. The Jewish women, especially Veronica, are sympathetic. Moreover, it's the Romans, the soldiers and the politicians, who are more consistently depicted as wicked. Some have, I think, correctly said that perhaps the best characterization in the film is that of Pilate, the most complex and interesting character. Some of the initial critics went on to say that, in fact, that this only supports the charge of anti-Semitism because the chief Roman antagonist to Jesus, Pilate, is presented so sympathetically. We can see ourselves in him. Now, it is true that he is, in a sense, presented sympathetically, perhaps even empathetically, but that seems to draw precisely the wrong lesson from what I would take to be Gibson's intended lesson, right? If we see that we're not so distant from Pilate, why think that that shows that Pilate wasn't so bad, rather than that we're a good deal worse than we might be inclined to to think? I mean, of course, I do think that it's in fact a dramatic failure in the film that the Jewish opponents of Jesus are seen without adequate justification for their hostility. In contrast, however, it seems to me that the Romans are shown to have various forms of, to have various types of motivation, but they're chiefly bad kinds of motivation. In fact, it seems to me what Gibson largely gives us here are various ways in which a variety of ways in which human beings essentially go bad. That is, that we sometimes give in to dangers to ourselves. We're willing to sacrifice others to our own benefit. We're willing to sacrifice others to our committed causes. We act from fear, and so on. So if you look at the Jewish and Romans, the Jewish and Roman actors, that is, participants in this drama, one sees a variety of motivations, and in part what one gets here is something of the range of human suffering. Of human evil doing, the different ways in which we go bad. Moreover, Jesus is himself addressed and referred to as a Jew, and it's the Romans who are chiefly shown to be contemptuous of Jews. It's hard to see how that depicts anti-Semitism in a positive way. Moreover, of course, Jesus, his family, and the disciples are all presented as Jews. Mary recites the Passover prayer. Jesus is addressed as a rabbi. He's tried by the Romans precisely as Jewish and seen, and his rise is seen as a Jewish problem. Again, the charge is made that the film departs from the USCCB guidelines, and in fact, even Vatican guidelines. But guidelines presumably are largely to be seen precisely as that, as guidelines. And here, I can't go into it, indeed it would take me beyond my own competence to get into that, but I take it that here again there's got to be a question of proportionality. To what extent are we required to abide by these, is an artist required simply to abide by these guidelines in such a way that they trump his or her own artistic vision? We don't have detailed information on just what Gibson was trying to do, but we do, he's made, he's given indications in some of his comments here, in some of his comments in various interviews, and so too, probably more revealingly, has his screenwriter. But the screenwriter seems to have taken a line not very different from that that Dr. Wolf suggested last night, right, where he talked about, where he cited Flannery O'Connor in saying that when you're dealing with the hard of hearing, you have to shout. In fact, Mary Gordon, who's no, it's a novelist, right, who's no fan of Gibson's film by a long shot, says that she posed her question, why this sort of depiction of the Passion, why this sort of story, precisely to the screenwriter, and he himself cited a similar story of Flannery O'Connor's, you know, a story of a man who buys a farm animal, is told that if he simply treats it, or if he treats it with loving care, it will do well for him. He buys the animal, treats it with care, and the animal does little or no work. He can't get it to, in fact, respond adequately. He brings it back to the salesman and salesperson and says, what was the matter? Salesperson picks up a 2x4 and hits it in the head. And when the purchaser says, but you said to treat it with loving kindness, he responds, yes, but first you have to get its attention. I take it in a somewhat similar way what Gibson is trying to do with the coarse and sometimes, well, oftentimes, and indeed perhaps pervasively violent and disturbing images in the film is precisely to get our attention. Many of the critics charge that Gibson hasn't then delivered. Some of them make the charge of a failure to deliver, I think, in a way that doesn't make a lot of doesn't make a lot of sense. That is, they charge Gibson with failing to follow through. Some of them think that, in fact, the way in which he's failed to follow through is that he's gotten the audience riled up looking for someone to hurt, but then hasn't given them anyone. And this only helps to, in their view, to support the charge of anti-Semitism, right? Support the charge that in this, in the film, what Gibson is doing is in fact instilling and tapping into long-standing traditions of violence and of hatred, Christian hatred against Jews. But of course, that's not the most sympathetic way of reading the kind of text that, that Gibson has presented us with, nor of understanding the kinds of artistic intentions with which he acts. Right. So, in fact, there's a somewhat different way of understanding, perhaps one that will take us back to Brecht's views on drama. If you recall, Brecht had rejected the Aristotelian conception of drama on the grounds that what we need to, what the dramatist needs to do in his Marxist understanding is not so much to deliver a catharsis through pity and fear, but rather to delay that. So what the artist needs to do is to engage our feelings, bring us up to the brink, and then stop in Brecht's view. Now, of course, as a Marxist, his understanding of the point of stopping at that point was precisely in order to get us to start the revolution. But if we, but that last part is simply a particular version of the view that the artist isn't supposed to follow through. Perhaps a more sympathetic way of understanding Gibson's effort in the film is that he's tried to bring us up to, is that he's engaged our feelings and caused us to reflect and then stopped in order then to lead us, to encourage us to go to undertake the kind of reform, the kind of change that's necessary on our own. In addition, the charge is made that there are homophobic, there are political elements beyond anti-Semitism. Let me just briefly mention some of those and try to move towards my conclusion. So there's a charge of homophobia. This appeared in more than one place. I guess the one that struck me the most was in the local alternative paper in Boston, the Phoenix, that complains about the Epicene, Satan, and the prancing Herod, showing Gibson's longstanding hatred of homosexuals. But here I think it's Father Cesario, in what I thought was probably the most intellectually penetrating discussion of the film that I've seen so far, in his article just recently published in St. Austin Review. And there he suggests that, in fact, the ambiguity of Satan, the Satan character, is precisely in order to remind us that, one thing, Satan represents all of us, right, man and woman, but more than that, that Satan is not what he seems, right? That he may seem to some extent this way, to some extent that way, and that always he is the father of lies. Again, there's criticism made that he's seen, that this demonic figure is seen moving through the Jewish crowd. But again, that's troubling only if one sees the crowd as representing Jews rather than the crowd as representing us, that is, human beings, right? And we see, and of course, a more sympathetic reading of what Gibson is up to suggests the latter understanding. As for the prancing Herod, you know, you can find that even in Jesus Christ Superstar, which is usually seen as a better depiction by those who are on that side. And in any case, sexual debauchery is presumably a tradition, a legitimate target. Theological charges have also been made against the film. For example, that it's spiritually empty. I won't try to rehash the many discussions along these lines. One finds some of them in some of the biblical critics or biblical scholars who have written on it. Or again, that it's spiritually empty. Weaselt here, again, one of the most vehement of the writers describes it as a sacred snuff film. He is, if nothing else, quite the phrase maker. And it comes out especially in his discussion of the film. Somewhat differently, also writing in the New Republic, Stanley Kaufman raises the question of the film's timing. That is, why make a film like this now, when there is such hostility against Jews already widespread and widely afoot? But again, this seems an odd claim to make for those on this side. I'm certainly it was chiefly to Jewish activists and others that we are chiefly indebted for the continuing phrase, reminder not to forget, never to forget. And I'm embarrassed as a putative scholar of these topics to say that it was only in reading the, I suppose it's the sort of thing that I should know as somebody who sometimes teaches Greek philosophy, and but it was, I'm embarrassed to say that it was only in reading part of the picture book that was released as a companion to the movie, and from Mel Gibson, who, whatever else one thinks of, is probably shouldn't be seen as a scholar. It's only from reading that that I learned what should have been pretty obvious from looking at the words, that aletheia, the Greek term for truth, goes back to lethe, to the river of forgetfulness. And indeed, so in writing about the truth, was also the way and the life. Gibson is helping us precisely not to forget. He's urging us to remember. And put that way, the question why now seems oddly clueless, right? The point is that this needs, that this is a perennial, indeed perpetual significance, the most significant event if the Christians are right, ever. And to ask the question why raise it now makes little sense within that context. Despite that, several of the writers in the New Republic insist that the charge that it's their failure to internalize Christianity that has anything to do with their views here, with their understanding of the film, they simply dismiss that charge, but it does seem to come out precisely in such cases. Let me, I'm eating up far too much of gum beyond my time, so let me just try to make a couple of final remarks here. Suggestion is, again, there's dealing with here is that the film is spiritually empty, but in addition, of course, to drawing on these spiritual traditions of the sorrowful mysteries of the stations of the cross, the film, I think, nicely illustrates or suggests the kind of substitutional atonement or an understanding of the atonement which has unfortunately come to be neglected and indeed sometimes denied by theologians. So in my conversations with my colleague, Professor Cunningham, he sees this as part of the naivete of the film. On the other hand, it's a little bit unclear just what it is that people are rejecting in that case. Gary Wills, from whom one, writing in the New York Review of Books, a person from whom one has come to expect a certain level of scholarship along with a good deal of invective, seems to me here simply to stumble. So although I wasn't expecting him to like it, I guess I was expecting higher quality criticism. But he stumbles here, suggesting that Augustine rejects what he calls the ransom theory of atonement, the view that Christ is paid as ransom to Christ. But as I'm not a theologian, but as I understood at least the way in which the ransom theory atonement has been, or the ransom understanding of atonement has been understood somewhat more recently as a distinct account, the ransom is one paid to Satan. So if when Augustine rejects that sort of ransom theory, that's quite different from rejecting substitutional atonement, the understanding that Christ has taken all of our sins on him, on himself. There are charges made that there's a militaristic conception of Christ's resurrection at the end of the film, and several of the critics, although I take it it's important that these are not, for the most part, Christian critics, have made the charge that the film indicates a contradiction. We are riled up and drawn to criticize, to feel anger here, to feel that this is some sort of terrible injustice, but then the charge is made, in fact, all of that is taken away, and on the substitutional theory, this isn't a tragedy, rather it was all necessary. But again, one doesn't have to be a theologian to say that both could be true, right, that the acts were atrocities, that these were acts of, that they were sinful, indeed hateful actions, while also being parts of the drama that God has destined from eternity. Okay, I was going to talk some about aesthetic complaints about the film and so on, but in fact, rather than go into that, maybe just let me end by gesturing towards those. So I hope then that whereas the initial controversy, the spring, the winter and spring controversy, you know, the sort of, the film's Lent, perhaps, was filled chiefly with political charges, mainly anti-Semitism, but also allied charges of insensitivity and hatred of homosexuals and so on. But now perhaps with the release on DVD and with the new books that are coming out on it, the reflection on the film can turn in a different direction, looking more to these spiritual themes, the charge of spiritual emptiness, and perhaps against that, questions of spiritual insight and benefit to be gleaned from reflection on the film, and of course, more important, from the story, that the film is only one effort, somewhat crudely, to dramatize or to depict, and similarly then to look to the aesthetic issues of the revivified visual field or visual iconography and the new ways in which film, but also other graphic arts, might now take this as an opportunity to look again with new eyes towards this most ancient and important of stories. Thank you.
Our second speaker will be Professor Thomas Hibbs, who is the Dean of the Honors College at Baylor University. Tom's written widely in medieval philosophy, but also has done a lot of writing on contemporary culture, and particularly the impact of film and television on that culture. Professor Hibbs.
I thought I'd try and say a little bit about, and only a little bit, about the films of Krzysztof Kieślowski, a Polish filmmaker who died in 1996, and the issue of chance and providence. Thinking, as Jorge was speaking about Alistair McIntyre's talk this morning, and I think what Jorge, through Mel Gibson, was discussing is much more like El Greco, or as Gibson wanted it to be, Caravaggio, and this is a lot more like Rothko. Toward the end of the film Red, the last in the Three Colors trilogy from Kieślowski, the main character, Valentin, states, "I feel something important is happening around me." Many of the films of the acclaimed Polish director feature characters who experience the growing realization that, as the philosopher Charles Taylor puts it, something incomparably important is involved in ordinary deliberations and choices. Although Kieślowski never explicitly affirms a particular answer to the sorts of questions his characters formulate, he does depict characters as caught up in and groping tentatively to articulate what Taylor calls inescapable moral horizons. As is clear from his most famous films, the Three Colors trilogy, Blue, White, and Red, and the Decalogue, a series of 10 one-hour films produced for Polish television, Kieślowski is preoccupied with issues of chance, fate, alternative possibilities, and the tentative suggestions of a providential design to the arc of human life. There are occasional explorations of these matters in structurally complex American films, such as Pulp Fiction, yes, I did say Pulp Fiction, and 13 Conversations About One Thing, both of which violate linear narration as a way of opening up questions about chance and providence. But the artistic subtlety of Kieślowski's films and the peculiar themes and moods of his plots place him firmly in the European tradition of filmmaking. Indeed, he's quickly acquiring a reputation as the most philosophical filmmaker since Bergman, whom Kieślowski greatly admired. Like Bergman, Kieślowski specializes in the depiction of characters who suffer a sort of dislocation, a loss of orientation, or deprivation of identity. In the Decalogue, he sought to describe ordinary everyday life, a world populated by people, as he put it, who do not know why they are living, who suddenly realize that they are going round and round in circles, not achieving what they want. Yet the realization of entrapment often allows Kieslowski's characters to begin to reflect on the purpose of their lives and to consider alternative paths. Kieslowski frankly admits that his films are about the big questions. What is right and wrong? What is honesty and dishonesty? In probing these questions, Kieslowski avoids the simplistic extremes of pat answers or easy skepticism. There is a kind of moral realism operative nonetheless in his films, akin to what Charles Taylor, akin to that espoused by philosophers like Charles Taylor, who proposed that we treat our deepest moral instincts as legitimate modes of access to ontological claims. Kieslowski said that the Three Colors films are all about people who have an intuition or sensibility. I have a section here on some of the recently released DVDs from his middle period, especially the film No End and Blind Chance. I'm going to skip that to talk about the ones that are a little better known. Kieslowski takes seriously the possibility of transcendence. In response to some critics who see his experimentation with nonlinear narrative and the elusiveness of the quest for meaning as signs of postmodern skepticism, one recent critic, Joe Kikasola, who's a colleague of mine at Baylor and has just published a terrific book called The Liminal Image in Kieslowski, he counters that Kieslowski does not divide the immanent and the transcendent so neatly. Instead, he often entertains the possibility that the temporal may intersect with the spiritual through mystery. Indeed, the points of possible intersection are multiple and arise from a variety of sources, from the perception of the possibility of redemptive suffering, of mercy in the face of evil, and from glimpses of a providential design to overlapping narratives. As Kieslowski himself put it in an interview, it's a beautiful passage, "I think there is a point at which all these trifling matters, all these little mysteries, come together like droplets of mercury to form a larger question about the meaning of life, about our presence here, what in fact went before and what will come after, whether there is someone who controls all this, or whether it all depends on our own reason or on someone or something else. The mystery is there all the time." With the exception of some of these storylines from these middle films, Kieslowski depicts in his later films characters trying to locate their lives in the context of some larger framework or meaning of meaning or purpose. Furthermore, he deploys numerous symbolic and dramatic devices to engender in the viewing audience sympathy with the main characters. Thus does he enhance our experience of the endings of even his darkest films as tragic, an experience that presumes that viewers retain a longing for something other and better than the fate of the main characters. His own experimentation in some of his early films with possible arcs, multiple possible arcs to a single human life, this is especially in the film Blind Chance, suggests the possibility of multiple incompatible endings, not all of which need be characterized by abnegation or despair. The possibility of a movement beyond blind, destructive chance, beyond tragic misunderstanding and the frustration of human aspiration, has much to do with the possibility of reconciliation in love. The latter are possible only if we can reverse the reduction of love to sex and of sex to the mechanical satisfaction of appetite. In Decalogue 6 on adultery, we find a profound meditation on the vice of lust and on the difference between voyeuristic pleasure and human communion. A young man uses binoculars to spy on a sexually active woman in an apartment adjacent to his own. When the woman finally learns of his observations, she toys with his affection, mocking his claim that his interest in her has moved beyond lust to something more. She seduces him, leaves him sexually spent with the admonition, "Love, there is no such thing." When the crestfallen young man disappears amid rumors that he has done himself bodily harm, she suddenly experiences remorse and surprise at her own remorse, and finds herself now in his former position, looking for signs of the presence of someone with whom she now desires to communicate in a human and compassionate rather than a perfunctory and cruel manner. Kieslowski depicts lust as an inordinate desire, not just for pleasure, but for the possession of what is not rightly one's own. It is interconnected with a set of vices, jealousy, wrath, and pride. A married woman who has been sleeping with another man explains initially that she believes it is possible to love two persons. As she begins to describe what each man provides for her, this could be the beginning of almost any movie featuring adultery. I think it's possible to love two people, and I'm doing it rather well at the moment. She begins to describe what each man provides for her, but then stops, pauses, reflects, and shifts from self-justification to self-accusation. It is not right, she says, to wish for everything. That's pride. From the episodes in Decalogue forward, Kieslowski offers increasingly rich dramas of the quest, featuring characters enveloped by an inescapable moral or metaphysical framework. To repeat the phrase from Valentine in Blue, something important is happening around me, she says, not in me or merely to me, but around me. Especially in the films from the trilogy, Kieslowski's characters move, however tentatively, in the direction of a realization of their role in a drama larger than their individual lives. The stories in Decalogue or in Three Colors can be appreciated independently of one another, but their cumulative emotional impact is palpable. In part, this is because, in Decalogue at least, the stories have the same setting, an economically depressed apartment complex in Warsaw. Kieslowski once joked, it's the most beautiful housing estate in Warsaw, which is why I chose it. It looks pretty awful, so you can imagine what the others are like. Contemporary films are rarely about ordinary folks or about the poor, whose lives reflect in immediate and dramatic fashion the vulnerability of the human condition. The very ordinariness of the lives in this particular setting lends a universal dimension to the stories in Decalogue. The multiple stories provide glimpses of the richness and depth that lie just beneath the surface of every human life. Or, as Kieslowski once put it, I believe the life of every person is worthy of scrutiny, containing its own secrets and dramas. In this way, his films overlap with philosophical themes central to the project of philosophers like Charles Taylor, who take his cue from common, ordinary experience of moral agent, who often have the sense that there may well be something important to discover about the point and purpose of their lives, that the framework in which they find their lives embedded, while open to possible reconsideration, even thorough alteration, is not an arbitrary construct. As Taylor puts it at one point, one orients oneself in a space that exists independently of one's success or failure in finding one's bearings, which, moreover, makes the task of finding these bearings inescapable. Such is the experience of many of Kieslowski's characters in Decalogue and Three Colors, particularly that of Julie in Blue, the first film in the trilogy based on the modern French and Enlightenment ideals of liberty, equality, and fraternity. Instead of a simple celebration of liberty, Kieslowski's film puts into question its meaning and value, its compatibility with a rich sense of identity and love. Having lost both her husband and daughter in a brutal car crash, Julie is, as Kieslowski notes, completely free. She has no family, no intimate friendships, no responsibilities, and possesses surplus wealth and time. In her fine commentary track on the DVD of this film, Annette Insdorf suggests that the film is an inquiry into the viability of freedom from the constituting conditions of a character's identity. The understanding of freedom in purely negative terms results in a horrifying vacancy. To be free from all frameworks, as Charles Taylor puts it, is to be in the grips of an appalling identity crisis. This is precisely Julie's situation at the opening of Blue. There's an intimate connection, Taylor goes on, between identity and a kind of orientation in moral space. This, it seems to me, is precisely the point of Kieslowski's abstract use of color and sound in Blue. At crucial junctures in Julie's return to the community of the living, not only is the color blue prominent, but also the strains of an unfinished symphony on which her husband, her adulterous husband, she learns not long after his death, was working at the time of his demise. In a mysterious and deeply symbolic scene, Julie leaves a cafe to confront a street musician who is playing portions of the unpublished and unfinished symphony. The scene suggests a rich overlapping and interlacing of lives, not by mere chance, but because each life has potential access to realms of reality that transcend and encompass each individual life. The depiction of convergent stories and parallel destinies is evident in Kieslowski's willingness to repeat certain themes in different stories and to introduce characters from one story into another. In Red's concluding scene of rescued survivors from a boat wreck, the survivors include not only two from Red, but also two from each of the previous films, from Blue and White. At the time of his death, Kieslowski was at work on another trilogy on Hell, Purgatory, and Heaven. His collaborator eventually released the one on Heaven in 2001. But the themes of damnation, purgation, and heavenly reconciliation already pervade Blue, White, and Red. Indeed, they're already all there in the first film, Blue. Julie's freedom in Blue is a kind of damnation, a deprivation of all human feeling and contact. White, meanwhile, offers a peculiar sort of meditation on equality, which in the absence of love is seen inevitably to degenerate into a petty competition for dominance, where the mastery of one partner gives rise to the resentment of the other. Kieslowski rejected as false the claim that what everyone wants is to be equal. What everyone wants, he said, is to be more equal. White is the story of the failed love between the inept Polish Karl and the sophisticated French Dominique. It opens with divorce proceedings in a Paris court. Unable to speak the language or keep up with the trendy and quick-witted Dominique, Karl is subject to the misunderstandings and insults of a foreigner. He leaves for Poland, recovers some of his strength, and then begins to plot his revenge. He fakes his own death. After the funeral, he visits Dominique, who's come to Poland for the funeral, in her hotel room, makes love to her as a sort of resurrected Karl, and then leaves her just before the police arrive to interrogate her in the Polish language she cannot speak for the murder of her ex-husband. But this isn't the end of the film. Instead, Kieslowski gives us a sort of dream sequence or prophecy in which Karl looks through binoculars at Dominique, who appears in a window with bars in front of it. Suddenly, the bars disappear. Dominique makes the image of a ring around her finger, and Karl cries. All three of these films end with one of the major characters weeping. In her commentary track on this scene, Annette Insdorf describes their state to that of limbo, but one might equally well call it purgatory, especially since at the end of Red, Karl and Dominique emerge from the submerged boat together. The sense that the way out of hell is by means of love and suffering for another is subtly suggested early in Blue itself, when the housekeeper of the inhumanly aloof Julie weeps in her presence. Julie asks, "Why are you crying?" To which the housekeeper responds, "Because you're not." Blue ends with Julie rewriting and completing her husband's unfinished symphony, which culminates with the setting to music of the Greek text of Paul's famous meditation from Corinthians on love. In his films, Kieslowski raises all sorts of philosophical puzzles, but he does so less through explicit dialogue than through complex artistry, the silent framing of what initially appear to be isolated objects, the visually imageless presentation of sound, the tendency toward abstraction in the use of colors and objects, and the subtle interweaving of lives and plots. In multiple ways, his films enhance our appreciation of moral and metaphysical phenomena in ways that philosophical argument alone cannot. Again, a quote from Taylor, "Moral argument and exploration go on only in a world shaped by our deepest moral responses. If you want to discriminate more finely what it is about human beings that makes them worthy of respect, you have to call to mind what it is to feel the claim of human suffering, or what is repugnant about injustice, or the awe you feel at the fact of human life. No argument," Taylor concludes, "can take someone from a neutral stance toward the world to insight into moral ontology." In the contemporary world, and I'm concluding now, there are numerous obstacles to recovering any sense of moral ontology. Kieslowski's films, early films, detailed the frustration of human desire by the communist bureaucracy. Of Decalogue, he commented that it was an attempt to return to the elementary values destroyed by communism. But he's equally skeptical about pure capitalism. The last episode of Decalogue, on coveting the goods of others, illustrates the destruction of human community by the profit motive of two brothers. Critics often see Kieslowski's films as presenting before us complex moral dilemmas. This seems to me true, but superficial. Choices are crucial, but they are not the sole determinants of the contours of the drama. The shape of things involves a mysterious confluence of what's within our control and what lies beyond it. The orchestration of events in a benevolent, if still obscure, direction suggests a providential structure to human life. At their best, these films are about the mediation of the divine in and through sensible realities, and about the sacramental bonds of the human community, especially in marriage and the rearing of children. These themes crystallize in the remarkable ending of the first film of Decalogue, where a father who is very committed to science and technology has predicted that the ice outside...
Please. The time is now 3:10 and the end of the current session. We have a couple of announcements. There'll be a book signing by Professor Michael Scapperlanda in the book room. He'll be signing his book, The Journey, A Guide for the Modern Pilgrim. Also, The people taking the Snipe Museum tour should be at the Snipe Museum by 3:40. It's building number 54 on your campus map and a quick two-minute walk from this building. Thank you.
Okay. The end of Decalogue 1, just very quickly. There were a father who had predicted for his son who wanted to go skating that the ice would, at a certain temperature, freeze and remain frozen. Ends in tragic loss for the father, who then vents his frustration in a kind of rage in his house and then wanders over to the church. He had before seemed to be an unbeliever, describing death as simply the heart ceasing to be. There in the church, he vents his anger at God and whacks as he hits some candles that are burning, as he collapses and sobs before an icon of the Virgin Mary. The icon itself, whether purely by chance, the one rendering of the ending is to say that the wax simply landed right at Mary's eye and then comes down. But there's clearly a symbol here of the imminent being invaded, in a sense, by the transcendent, by Mary's mercy and sorrow at the loss of this man. So on the big issues, including religious truth, Kieslowski himself was unsettled. He embarked on a self-described quest. What is the meaning of life? Why get up in the morning? Politics doesn't answer that, he said. With Decalogue and Three Colors, he lays claim to being one of the most profound of contemporary filmmakers, offering us examples of what film can teach us about who we are as human beings, destined for but habitually lapsing from transcendence. Thank you.
I fear the voice from above has spoken the truth, so that our session will have to officially conclude. But any of you who would like to hang around for, say, 10 minutes or so of some informal question and answer, could you maybe come to the front, and then we could stay here. I'm sure some of you have to get going, too. So we will officially break at this point, but as long as our speakers are willing to hang around for a little bit, we can have some informal question and answer, but I wanted to give anybody who needs to get away a chance to break out without feeling like you're stopping us.